subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with the island nation Sri Lanka, where the Rajapaksa brothers have once again secured a thumping victory, this time in the parliament elections. Sri Lanka Porujana Peramuna party clinched 145 out of 225 seats. And now, with a 5-seat support from allies, the Rajapaksa brothers' 2-3 majority in the parliament will enable them to make changes in the constitution.
A landslide victory for Mahinda Rajapaksa marks history for Sri Lanka, as he has a mandate to give country a certain direction. The victory for the elder brother who led Sri Lanka in defeating LTTE came 9 months after President Gotabaya Rajapaksa was elected to power with about 52% majority. With 145 seats in a 225-seat legislature and a support of 5 ally seats, the Rajapaksa brothers are now powerful enough to give a definite path to the country that has lately been plagued with sagging economy and issues of internal security. The leaders can also revoke country's 19th constitutional amendment, a long-standing campaign promise from last year. With just 1 seat to former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremasinghe's party, the observers say that people's mood has shifted towards the Sinhala nationalism.
අද දින ලබා දුන්න මේ ඓතිහාසික ජයග්‍රහණය අපි විශේෂයෙන්ම සාමකාමී භුක්ති විඳින්න ඕන මොකද අපිට මේ ලැබිච්ච ජනවරම උමතුවෙන් උඩඟු වෙන්න ඕන ජනවරමක් නෙමෙයි මේ ජනවරම සම්පූර්ණයෙන්ම ලබා දුන්නේ අපේ ජනාධිපතිතුමා ගෙන යන මේ රටේ වැඩපිළිවෙල ගැන මේ රටේ ජනතාව කරපු විශ්වාසයට
Neighboring leaders were quick to congratulate Mahindra with Indian leader Modi, who has been seeking an improved cooperation with the island nation, was first to dial Colombo. India-Sri Lanka bilateral engagement will be of prime importance in Rajapaksa's tenure, as the country has already been deceived into massive Chinese debts. The Rajapaksa team and his supporters say that Mahindra's younger brother Gotabaya has been phenomenal in dealing with COVID crisis that has become a major challenge in country's growth in recent times. It was this support and satisfaction that translated into party's victory.
තුනෙන්දේක ලැබීමේ අපේ ප්‍රධාන අරමුණ නම් රට ජාතිය වෙනුවෙන් වැඩ කරන හොඳ රාජ්‍ය නායකයෙක් අපිට හම්බෙලා තියෙනවානේ. මේ රාජ්‍ය නායකයාගේ විය යුතු සේවය අපි බලාපොරොත්තු වෙනවා එසේම කියන්නේ අපි බලාපොරොත්තු වෙන සේම ලැබෙන්න කියලා.
Earlier, Sri Lankans lined up before polling stations on August 5th wearing mask and social distancing to elect a new parliament. Braving the threats of coronavirus, more than 70% voters of 16 million eligible voters cast their votes. The tourism-dependent island nation of 21 million people has been struggling since deadly militant attacks on hotels and churches last year. Painful lockdowns to slow the spread of the novel coronavirus has also affected the daily lives of Sri Lankans.
Moving on, a swift rise in the coronavirus cases hasn't been able to thwart the pace of life in India. Preventive measures like masks and social distancing have kept the flow moving. An upped contribution from citizens has further strengthened country's fight as people have come up with several ideas and initiatives to challenge the pandemic. Government, on the other side, has further eased restrictions that were imposed in wake of outbreak to stem the spread.
Months-long wait for millions of fitness enthusiasts in India is over, as the government has allowed reopening of gyms and yoga centers. The states will enforce their individual SOPs to allow people to enter these places. The decisions come in line with the country making gradual moves towards reopening its entire economy following record fiscal deficit of $88.5 billion in April to June quarter due to the pandemic. Except for the academic institutions and metro, almost every economic activity in country is now open. New Delhi has also given a green flag to sports activities with standard operating procedures to be strictly followed. Indian Premier League, India's world-renowned franchisee cricket tournament, is set to be held after 6 months of delay. And the decisions have not been unreasonable and arbitrary. While the spike has been rapid, so has been the recovery rate. With little over 2%, the coronavirus death rate in India has been one of the lowest across the world.
पहली बार हुआ है कि पहले लॉकडाउन के बाद यानी 25 मार्च के बाद से देश का जो केस फेटलिटी रेट है वो अपने लोएस्ट सबसे न्यूनतम स्तर पर है 2.10. अगर आप देखें जून के दूसरे सप्ताह में केस फेटलिटी रेट 3.36 था, फिर जुलाई के दूसरे सप्ताह में वो घटकर 2.69 हो गया और आज जब हम आपसे अभी विमर्श कर रहे हैं तो वो 2.10% है।
The country has ramped up its health infrastructure significantly to fight the pandemic. India currently has 1,370 dedicated COVID hospitals, 3,062 dedicated COVID health centers, and 10,334 COVID care centers. Encouraging news, however, has been that a major section of these hospitals is unoccupied. Citizens and private organizations, too, have been instrumental in the fight against the pandemic. A businessman in India's western Surat city has converted his office into a COVID-19 facility for the treatment of the poor and needy for free of cost. He says he wants his city to be prepared for any challenge posed by COVID-19.
ये 84 बेड हैं, ऑलमोस्ट 100 बेड जैसे हो जाएंगे, पर 84 हाल में 84 बेड है, जिसमें 74 बेड जो है वो ऑक्सीजन वाले हैं और 10 जो है वेंटिलेटर वाले बेड हैं आईसीयू के साथ।
Another exemplary work has been done by an Indian non-profit organization which has been running Borki Shala, a local term in Marathi for spoken school. It has started taking pre-recorded lessons to students in rural areas who haven't been able to go to school for months due to coronavirus lockdowns.
Really good to see that the students, the small ones, the younger ones get their younger siblings also, and they come hurriedly, they get their notebooks, they get their textbooks, and they sit into the circles, you know, that we have made, of course, for social distancing, but that's like an important gesture that they come and they sit into those circles. They will not sit anywhere else, even if there is space.
Schools in India have been shut for over 4 months. Children in cities have been able to continue classes online. But in remote villages, where phones do not have a continuous reception of network and electricity is infrequent, these classes have proven to be a boon.
Moving on. The Baloch nationalists have upped the ante with its political wing carrying out protests across various global cities. Recently, it carried out a demonstration in Germany seeking an immediate intervention of the European Union into the abduct and kill policy of Pakistan Army, in line of which five Balochs were recently killed by Pakistani forces.
Pakistan Army! Pakistan Army!
These anti-Pakistan shouts seem to have become a common phenomenon in Europe, with leaders from political wing of anti-Pak Baloch movement taking to streets in different countries every week. This is an exact reflection of barbarities being mounted and increased with time on innocent Baloch by Pak Army and its agents in the region. This protest in Hanover City in Germany is seeking European Union intervention in the wake of five more Baloch being hacked to death by Pakistani Army on the eve of Eid al-Adha.
Today, we Baloch and activists of Baloch African Party protesting in German city Hanover against the recent massacre of Pakistani state forces in Balochistan. On the first day of Eid, we have received five dead bodies of Mukti Baloch missing persons who were already listed in the missing person list of International Voice of Missing Persons. We condemn this act of brutality of Pakistan Army. We request this world, we request the United Nations, we request the European Union, we request the human rights activists to stand with us and help us against this brutal act of Pakistani Army.
While these five Bukti men were the latest targets of Pak security agencies, the list of people being kidnapped and killed has been increasing every day in Balochistan. The list that predominantly included political activists, journalists and other intellectuals have now been extended to educated youths, women and children as well. As per Baloch accounts, state-sponsored violence, abduction, torture and killing have become a new normal in Balochistan. Around 53,000 Baloch have disappeared till date, some under suspicious conditions, some in broad daylight. The state hasn't spared women and children. Activists say that these constantly rising attacks on Baloch are to instill a sense of fear, but Pakistanis will never succeed.
They want to have a fear in the heart of Baloch. This will not happen. This will not happen. What they're trying to do is, they are killing the cream of our society, so that we have a fear and we give up, so that they will do the loot and plunder of our wealth and survive. This army, the properties of these generals must be investigated. How come they become so rich? You are a government servant, and look at your lifestyle, and look at your families. They are surviving and thriving with our wealth. This must be stopped.
International observers say that it is the Chinese influencing the security policies of Pakistan in the region. They have been instructing Islamabad to get rid of local people in the Gwadar region where multi-billion flagship project CPEC culminates. Chinese strategies that have been deemed expansionist by more than organization in the world are to develop a base for themselves in the region. Pakistan, which is already under massive Chinese debt, has no option but to follow commands. However, Pakistan is unique in a sense that no country across the world kills people whom it calls its own.
Moving on, Pakistan is rattled by the steps taken by India vis-a-vis Kashmir in last 1 year. Abrogation of Article 370, followed by robust socio-economic development, has torn down its decades-old plans of subverting peace in the region. Rhetoric, propaganda and provocation is all Pakistan seems to have left with today. While PM Imran Khan has peddled lies across international forums, Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi has challenged Indian PM Narendra Modi to visit Kashmir under his occupation without telling the world the ground reality, a gradually shaping up humanitarian crisis in POK. South Asia Focus will show some. Have a look.
Widespread unemployment, poor health care and dismal education system. This is Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Successive Pakistani regimes have failed or can be said have deliberately kept the region and its people deprived of fundamentals. The underlying rationale has been simple. Since it was never a part of actual Pakistan in 1947, so was not accorded an equal treatment even after its invasion. When compared with other provinces, POK falters at almost every parameter of growth, with security forces, mainly the army, keeping a constant check on civil and political liberties of people. Political activists have either been forced to flee or have been sentenced for decades of imprisonment. Discrimination spanning from educational institutions to jobs has further aggravated people's quality of life. Demands have either been ignored or crushed brutally. The frustration and anger have translated into protests, and one group or the other can be seen demonstrating on streets every day. These students are protesting the university's arbitrary decision of raising their semester fee.
हम लॉकडाउन की वजह से बहुत सी मुश्किलात का सामना कर रहे हैं। उन्हीं हालात में हमें एक बहुत बड़ा पहाड़ हमारे सर पे डाला गया है, जो फीसों का है। इस वक्त हालात के पेश नजर हमारा एक ही मुतालबा है कि हमारी फीस को माफ किया जाए, और अभी हमारा हम पूरा अमल एहतजाज कर रहे हैं, हमें मजबूर न किया जाए कि हम अगले इस तरह का हल करें ताकि हम अपने अपने जोर पे अपनी फीसें माफ करवा सकें।
And this is not even the tip of the iceberg of sufferings in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Islamabad-backed terrorists have established their headquarters in the region. United Nations Human Rights Office of the High Commissioner had reported in 2019 that dreaded terrorist groups responsible for subverting peace in India were based in POK. The report had also highlighted that Pakistan had imposed heavy curbs on peaceful assembly and freedom of expression. But look at the brazenness of Pakistani leadership. It has been constantly peddling lies about Jammu and Kashmir, the region which has marked major developments in just 1 year. Islamabad has been working overtime to manufacture a narrative of Kashmiri sufferings, but to its failure, nobody is buying its version.
मैं खुद दुनिया के सारे टॉप लीडर से बात की, उनको बार-बार समझाया, डोनाल्ड ट्रंप को दो-तीन दफा समझाया कि कश्मीर कितना खतरनाक है दुनिया के लिए, फ्लैश पॉइंट है, चांसलर मर्कल जर्मनी की, बोरिस जॉनसन, इन सब से मैंने खुद बात की, मैक्रॉन जो फ्रांस के प्रेसिडेंट, इन सब से मैंने बातें की, सबको समझाया कि ये हो क्या रहा है। कईयों को समझ ही नहीं थी कश्मीर की, लेकिन आहिस्ता आहिस्ता समझ आनी शुरू हुई।
In a step that has been ridiculed by near Delhi as political absurdity, Pakistan has unilaterally made cartographic changes to its map that includes several parts of India. No wonder Pakistan leadership has gained mastery in pulling off such stunts. Its ministers, who are otherwise a subject of mockery in global diplomatic circuits, have gone a step ahead and challenged Indian Prime Minister.
आखिरी पैगाम मेरा है वजीर आजम हिंदुस्तान से, अगर तुम्हें एतमाद है अपने किए पर तो मैं बहसीत पाकिस्तान के वजीर खारजा, आज एक साल की आपकी पॉलिसी का नफाज हो गया, मैं आपको दावत दे रहा हूँ, आइए मुजफ्फराबाद में कश्मीरियों से मुखातिब हो जाएं।
डोंट फॉरगेट, this is election time in Gilgit-Baltistan, Kashmir's extended region under Pakistan's occupation. Meanwhile, India has already spent over 80% of humongous $10.7 billion announced for Kashmir by Modi government through various projects and schemes for Kashmiri welfare. People have expressed overwhelming support to the government undertakings and the initiatives being rolled out for them.
Moving on, India is a vast country with diverse cultures and ancient civilization. The practice of going for a pilgrimage is deeply embedded in the Indian culture. In Ayodhya, the birthplace of Lord Rama, a massive temple will be constructed which will attract millions of Hindu devotees from all over the world. On August 5, Prime Minister Narendra Modi laid the foundation stone of Ram Temple after participating in a Bhumi Pujan ritual.
Hindu devotees celebrated the occasion by lighting lamps and bursting crackers in cities across the country on 5th of August, following prayer ceremony for construction of Lord Ram Temple in the holy city of Ayodhya. The city was illuminated with earthen lamps covering the banks of Saryu River as part of Deepotsav or Lamps Festival. Meanwhile, a mega light show was also held as the whole city was illuminated. On the grand occasion, Prime Minister Narendra Modi performed rituals and took part in the Ram Temple Foundation stone laying ceremony.
राम मंदिर के लिए कई कई सदियों तक, कई कई पीढ़ियों ने अखंड अविरत एक निष्ठ प्रयास किया है। आज का ये दिन उसी तप, त्याग और संकल्प का प्रतीक है। श्री राम का मंदिर हमारी संस्कृति का आधुनिक प्रतीक बनेगा, और मैं जानबूझकर के आधुनिक शब्द का प्रयोग कर रहा हूं। हमारी शाश्वत आस्था का प्रतीक बनेगा, हमारी राष्ट्रीय भावना का प्रतीक बनेगा, और यह मंदिर करोड़ों करोड़ लोगों की सामूहिक संकल्प शक्ति का भी प्रतीक बनेगा।
The ceremony was performed by priests chanting Sanskrit slokas under a giant murky decorated in shades of red and yellow as Modi and other dignitaries, all in face mask, maintained social distancing. On the occasion of the Bhumi Puja, soil and holy water from several religious places across India, Triveni Sangam of rivers Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati at Prayagraj, Kamakhya Temple in Assam and many others were collected.
पूरा देश दीपावली मना रहा है, ऐसा लग रहा है कि आज दीपावली फिर से लौट कर आ गई, फिर मेरा राम का जन्म हुआ है, फिर अयोध्यापति लंका को जीत कर आया है।
Ayodhya is regarded as one of the seven sacred cities of the Hindus, revered because of its association in the great Indian epic poem Ramayana with the birth of Ram and with the rule of his father Dashrath.
India boasts of a multi-ethnic and multi-religious diversity and its peaceful coexistence. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.